thank you so much for having me. I'm really delighted to be here. I've tried to explain to mostly my family what I do for many years, and the closest thing that I've come up with is sort of a new field called a biomedical science producer. So because I am a faculty member at the Icahn Institute, I have some official titles, and I run something called the Sharing Lab. And I also am executive director of a nonprofit called personalgenomes.org, and I also am president of another nonprofit called diybio.org. And so I've done a lot of different things, but being a biomedical science producer is really somebody who works with teams to build research projects that people want to join. And typically in that, trying to innovate across different levels, being governance, technology, and engagement. And so I'm going to get into some of that. And so this is going to be a little bit of an idiosyncratic talk. I mean, it is a lunch brown bag, and so I wanted to really kind of make it wide-ranging. And I'm totally comfortable with anybody jumping in at any time. So I have a bunch of to share with you about some of the work that I've done and some vignettes and things that I've learned and things that where I think there are needs. And don't feel like you should wait till the end, unless there's a policy for, if you prefer, for video. Okay. So I mentioned that I work at the Icahn Institute, and the other organizations just are personalgenomes.org and DIYBio. And I just wanted to mention that these are really sort of fringe activities, so you sort of get a perspective of who I am, and each in their own way. And they've done and each of these organizations work on a couple of really exciting programs that I'm not going to go into a lot of detail, but I just want to mention them so you can look them up. So personalgenomes.org has three programs, openhumans.org, the Global Network of Personal Genome Projects, and the Git Conference. And there's an associated sort of program in that called Git Labs. And then DIYBio, I work mostly on prototyping a few different projects and programs. One is a biohacker hotline called Ask a Biosafety Officer, and another is a biohacker code of ethics. But those are, you know, sort of nights and weekends kinds of activities for me these days. But I love doing this, and I've done this for several years of taking a quick poll, and I get a lot of different responses. And I'd love in this audience of a lot of different backgrounds to know whether or not anybody, just to take a straw poll of hands, to see if anybody in this room is enrolled in, actively enrolled, where you like sign a consent form, and if you wanted to go make a phone call or open an app and withdraw from a study, that you would like know where to do that and how to do that. Is anybody actively enrolled in a research study right now, a health-related research study?
Does 23andMe count?
It depends. Do you sign up for the research component? So one, two, anybody else? We have two. So I knew that this was going to happen because I don't care if I'm at a medical conference, a health research conference, the results are always the same. You know, somewhere around 1% of audiences polled, and I would love real numbers about this. I think we should try to get inserted into the next Pew consumer research survey to get an actual sort of national barometer on this question of how many people are actively engaged in health research right now. And it's a paradox to me, because if you look at other Pew surveys of like trusted professionals, right? Scientists and doctors are way up there. You look at social issues that are important to people, health, way up there. But if you bring those two things together, the number of people who are actively participating in health research right now, very, very small numbers. And so the question is, why is this a fringe activity? And I think it's a major social problem. And I have all kinds of theories about that. I don't have a lot of hard evidence. But if anybody actually experiences a health research study today, I think you'd be shocked to find that the experience is really just dreadful. It's very transactional. You don't really have any rights in it other than signing a consent form, and there is some agreement in there, but you're lucky to get at the end of the project, you know, a newsletter or something. But typically, it's transactional in the sense of you sign a consent form, you get a tube of blood, and then nobody talks to you again. And so, to me, it's really no surprise that the health research enterprise has such low rates of participation. And I think there is real opportunity for biomedical science producers to come in and fix this problem. And it's going to be a major team effort that spans a lot of different professions to produce health research studies that people actually want to sign up for and that can, you know, generate social benefit. And so I just want to talk one that's a work in progress. And so this talk comes at a time for me where I'm just over a year in on the design of a really large-scale biomedical health research study called the Resilience Project. So I'm not going to go into a lot of the nuts and bolts today about how that's put together, but I'm going to try to reflect on some of the issues and challenges of putting together research projects and go into some details and vignettes. But the Resilience Project, I think it's good to start with a story and a real person. So this is Doug, who lives in Washington State, and this is a photo borrowed from the New York Times. This was on the front page a couple weeks ago. And he is a resilient candidate, as what a new term that we would call him. He's had something like 15 family members over two generations die of a really nasty form of Alzheimer's that strikes around 40, and death within 10 years around 50. So his mother died of this disease. She had 10 siblings, nine of them, or it was a very large family, or something like nine of them died of the disease. And he has brothers and cousins and a lot of problems in this family. So he reached the age of 65 and assumed that he dodged the genetic bullet, because this is a disease which is autosomal dominant, inherited, highly penetrant. If you have this variant, in most other case, you're going to get the disease. We don't know exactly when, but it's going to be early onset. It's going to be devastating, and it's going to be fatal. And so he's 65 and assumed he didn't have it, but wanted to give back, joined a research study. To everybody's surprise, he has the variant. And so the question is, what's special about Doug? And so Doug is a case where he, by chance, it appears, has some biological property in his body that's buffering the negative impact of this genetic variant. And we don't know what it is, but we are in the process of, you know, decoding. Doug is being decoded right now. And I'm going to go into a little bit of what that means to try to find what it is that's protecting him from the disease. And the question is, you know, it might be something that if we learn how it works, it could be applied to other people. So the Resilience Project, the hypothesis is, to go from the general to the, or for the specific to the general, that, you know, we're missing a huge part in disease research. We're missing a big group of people, which are healthy people, and that there are actually healthy people walking around who are carrying highly penetrant genetic mutations that you would think that in most people cause disease, but they don't get it. But because they don't manifest the disease, they don't ever get into the track of research. So typically what happens when people join research studies, and this is, I think, goes to part of the misconception of the lacking engagement of health research right now, is that people think of health research as like, oh, if I get cancer and the first line therapy doesn't work, like maybe I'll join a clinical trial and try an experimental therapy. Well, research is really, you know, much bigger opportunity than that. We're still really trying to understand basic human variation and not even sort of applied in cancer. Obviously, that's important too. But the typical way people get into research is when a disease manifests and they go see a doctor, and somewhere along the way they join a research study related to that disease. And so we really look at people with disease and we don't look at people without disease. And so this really, the approach here is going to sort of turning disease research on its head. And we have scattered evidence in medicine that there are real opportunities out there for making important discoveries. And so if you look at sort of towards the end of the AIDS epidemic in the United States in the 90s, a really smart group of clinicians and researchers identified a cluster of positive outliers who were infected with HIV, but never went on to develop AIDS. And so they were like, what's up with this group of people? They've been infected with HIV and they never went on to develop AIDS. And it amazes me today, you know, knowing where technology is and high throughput genome sequencing and those sorts of things. And to think that in the 90s, they were able to get this group of people together, you know, draw blood and identify a genetic variant, which turned out to be something called CCR5. And so they said, oh, you know, these people have this variant in common. What's the mechanism? Like, what's it involved in? Turned in after, you know, doing laboratory work on this, you know, they identified that it was a protein. It was involved in a protein that lived on the cell surface, and HIV required this protein to bind, to go into the cell and integrate and replicate in the cell. And if you had the CCR5 mutation, the protein didn't work, and the HIV never integrated to the cell. And so now one of the leading therapies for people infected with HIV is a drug that basically targets this protein and mimics this genetic variant that was found naturally in some people. And so that's the sort of end-to-end story where, you know, you could actually find people who are protected and use those insights to develop new paths to therapies. And so in this project, since nobody's systematically gone to look for resilient people, we don't know how common they are. And obviously it depends also on how you frame the study. You know, we, for scientific reasons, we're gonna start looking at childhood disease in adults, of adults who are carrying highly penetrant, devastating variants related to, you know, hundreds of childhood diseases. And sort of by the fact that you're 18 means that you are likely resilient because you've survived to 18. And so like the phenotyping's easier. It gets harder when you do, if we were to go on and look at, you know, age-related diseases and resilience, because you don't know if the person, if they're 75, if they're just a year away from getting the age-related disease, so it gets a little bit trickier. But anyways, we don't know how common resilience to disease is. And just the sort of general approach to give you, I think it's important for when you're thinking about sort of designing a biomedical research study and like what's involved in that, is that there are three different components, three major different components. First is a huge search, where basically anybody can sign up, spit into a tube, and have their DNA analyzed, for example, for, you know, childhood Mendelian variants related, or childhood Mendelian disease. And if you carry two copies, if you get flagged as having one of these, then you might be termed a resilient candidate, where you're an adult, but you're carrying a childhood disease variant. What's the deal? We want to look more deeply. And so then it would be looking at the person's medical records and phenotype to see if they manifest the disease, and confirming that they do in fact sort of have the genetic variant and lack the disease manifestation. And then if you're like Doug and you do that workup and you don't have, well, like him, he doesn't have tangles in his brain or plaques in his brain, and he lacks the phenotype of Alzheimer's, then it would go on to decoding. And the decoding, and this gets to, I think, the sort of big data intersection in some sense, the N equals one big data in some ways with a lot of the things that you think about, what we call the decoding. And this is where we would take one individual and we would apply, you know, every technology under the sun to a blood sample, where we would do whole genome sequencing, we would do microbiome analysis and RNA and immunome and create cell lines, and develop and try to get as much information about this person's medical history and layer all that information in, and then invite every qualified scientist in the world, if the person consents to that level of sort of open science, to help us understand the data. Because, you know, some of the most complex problems in human health are gonna be solved by doing analysis that is so complicated and requires that it's almost impossible to imagine, unless you are a giant pharmaceutical company and you've got gazillions of dollars and you're just going to go license all the technology and you're going to go hire all of the faculty members, you're going to bring them internal, and you're going to walk, you know, and you are going to have an internal research program like this. But if you are instead, you know, academic researcher, and you don't have gazillions of dollars for this program, can you form a lower cost, more, you know, collaborative program where you invite scientists to come in and sort of take a piece of the puzzle and help to decode an individual across all these different layers and look for signals for like where the protection's coming from. So you know, being a biomedical science producer, then it's like, okay, this is what we want to do. Now build it, you know. And so I'm going to talk about a little bit about design methodologies, and this is really at a high level and not in any detail. But I just want to give you some idea of the type of work that's involved here. Has anybody here actually been involved in designing a biomedical research study? No. Okay, good. Well, that makes it, I think, a little bit more informative. So there are lots of different approaches to design. And there's, you know, a couple of really popular methods, the waterfall method, the agile method. And they have different sort of cycles and cost involved in, you know, iterating. Where the waterfall method is, you know, you do all of the design and requirements gathering up front, and then you build, and then the value comes at the end, right? And with an agile project, it's something where you do much more faster design iterations, and you're sort of creating value and learning at a much faster rate. And so, depending on what you're doing, these things get configured in different ways. You know, if you're Intel and you want to build a chip fabrication plant, it's a, you know, the agile, the design of that isn't really going to work for you, right? So this is something where it might cost $6 billion and it takes 10 years. And you're going to spend a huge amount of time in the design and the learning part of it. And so for like Intel, for example, for them, it takes so much money, it takes so long to build these chip fabrications. They have to predict where the market's going to be 10 years from now when this plant's done. If they missed the transition from phones being really the driver of of computing rather than desktops, and they didn't realize that 10 years ago and had a plant cranking out chips for mobile phones rather than desktop computers, then that's a major problem, right? And so they do a lot of forecasting anyways. And then for, you know, software engineering, it's really this lower model where, you know, you might actually be delivering a new version of your product every day, you know, or 3 weeks. You know, people do different things. But so for a scientific research study of something like the Resilience Project, where these are pretty much every single one of these types of people, and sometimes multiples of them, were involved in the design of the next iteration of the Resilience Project. I'm just going to spend a minute going through some of them so you can get a sense. A principal investigator, right? Typically, there's some visionary scientist who says, "Hey, this is a really important problem, and here's a potential thing, you know, hypothesis or program I'd like to get going." And there's a, you know, extended scientific team with maybe a clinical expert or multiple clinical experts, scientific experts, and, you know, math people and informatics people. And then on the actual platform component, you know, increasingly, you know, research, a lot of research still gets done with paper consent forms and enrollment of 70 people in a hospital over 5 years, right? But to go to scale anymore, it's platforms driven, right? There's now Research Kit on the iPhone, and you need, you know, web, you need a website and an app and that kind of thing. So you need user interface designers and software engineers and security experts and de-identification experts related to sort of data management and an API designer, right? And then there's a whole bunch of components of operations and a research coordinator and outreach, how you're going to find people to sign up. And then ethics consultant, governance expert, legal consultant, regulatory, all in there about, you know, how are you going to get your research, the design of your research study, you know, how are you going to make it, you know, ethically appropriate and responsible and through the IRB and satisfying New York state law and federal law and then a bunch of advisors, funders, sponsors, vendors, participants. And so part of the reason why I'm going through this is because this is a really, really, really high friction process. And it's very expensive, it's very hard, it's very time consuming. And so there is a major lack of innovation, particularly around things that a lot of people in this room care about, with governance, right, and platforms and new models of equity in research. And with the amount of friction and the high transaction cost of going through this process, where you might spend a year on the design and 3 to 6 months of working with the IRB to get approval. So over a year, and there might have been a 2-year funding cycle before you went in to actually being able to design and build something. And so this is a very high transaction cost. And so what researchers do a lot is just say, you know what, I'll just take whatever boilerplate consent form there is, right? I don't want to make any waves there. And I will take anything that makes my life easier. And so people are reluctant to go in and try to modify things that are going to just add, you know, this to expand and make it harder. And so, and because if you make a mistake with something like the IRB, which is going to take 3 to 6 months, you don't just like, you go sort of back to the end of the line and that clock starts over again. And you're going to go back and you're going to get feedback and say, well, I don't like what you've done here. This is not acceptable. We think you should do it this other way. And you might go back and through a multi-month process again. And so I, having seen this experience in academic research, I now understand why what often happens at the very end of it is that you get a data silo, right? Where the individual research participants, you know, there's a funny thing that happens right now in research where what is the sort of standard mode of operation is that that data is exclusively, more or less, for all intents and purposes, exclusively controlled by the principal investigator of the research study. And the individual research participants don't get access to it, to the data at all. And knowing that this is sort of the what's happening behind the scenes, I don't want to sort of justify that that is the way that it is, but knowing that the cost and the time expense for at the very end, finally generating data that you can learn from, that it's no surprise to me that there are that data is viewed as very sort of trade secret, proprietary, and not a whole lot of interest in sharing and having the data get out until the researchers involved have the ability to publish as much as they want, and they get to decide who their partners are and who else is going to collaborate. but you know, there are a lot of cases. So first of all, you know, just want to say, just because you have a great design process where you say, you know what, I want to try something new in biomedical research. I want to try a new form of governance. I want to innovate on informed consent. I want to innovate in data sharing. I want to innovate in new roles that participants can play other than the transactional, give a tube of blood, data's generated, nobody ever talks to you again. And even if there are some recent cases of people really wanting to be more equitable and to really learn what research participants want out of an endeavor. And that doesn't always guarantee a good outcome. And so one little vignette, the Veterans Administration has a program called the Million Veterans Program, MVP. And, you know, their aim was to study 1 million veterans. And it's an ongoing research project. And they, May 2009, they commissioned the Genetics and Public Policy Center at Johns Hopkins, say, look, this is a multi-million dollar endeavor over many years, and we want to do participant-centered design. And so let's go out to all the vets and see what they want, right? Because we want to design a research study that somebody wants to sign up for. And not to understate the risk of designing a research study that people don't want to sign up for if your goal is really ambitious, like signing up 1 million people, like the Resilience Project. The goal of that is a million people, 1 million veterans, obviously 1 million people. And there was a recent, I'm not going to talk too much about it, or not really, just in passing, you should look up the Children's Health Study. The government spent around $1 billion, and they ended up enrolling something like 1,000 children, and then canceled the project because it wasn't working out. And so when you are planning on going out and doing, you know, very large scale efforts, some of which are required to answer some of the questions that people want about health, this participant-centered design becomes really important. But just because you do it, as this veterans study will show, doesn't mean you're going to get the good outcome. So what did they find? So they found that, here's just two pieces of information. 9 of 10 veterans agreed that they would want to know all of their research results. right? So 90 plus percent said, yeah, I want the research results available to me. And two-thirds said that they would probably not join if they didn't get the results returned to them. And this goes into the sort of equity of the situation, right? And then after, you know, many millions of dollars spent on this consumer research and launching the program, front and center of the webpage, FAQ, will the results of my blood test be forwarded to me? And then, you know, here's your lump of coal. After all of the hoopla of doing participant-centered design, it's not possible for us to give you back your results. And it's really easy to come up with a long list of reasons why things are not possible, I've found. I learned recently in terms of thinking about designing a biomedical research study, I just want to pass on sort of something of a heuristic that I think is really useful, and I learned this from Stephen Friend. I don't know if he invented it or if he got it from somebody else. But when you're designing a research study, you really should be, you know, in the very early stages, in addition to saying, like, what are your values and what are the principles that you want to, you know, engender in this program, who are you designing for and what are you designing for? Are you designing for the researcher or for the participant? Are you designing for medical care or for discovery? Because depending on what you're trying to do, you're going to bring those components together and it's going to look a lot different, right? And so in the model that we're still pretty much in for the most part, the participant, the reason why this is like so innovative to me, right? It's so simple, but it's so exciting to see is because the participants are even like up there at all, really. Because the old model is it's really sort of a researcher designing a study and just deciding whether or not, you know, it's going to be a discovery research effort or a clinical effort, right? And that is also increasingly a very confusing line that might be artificial with learning healthcare systems and things like that. But then, you know, out in the wild, there is a sort of parallel universe happening where you get the other dimension. And this is really the quantified self movement, right? And these are, people aren't designing their own self-tracking research studies with the goals of like what researchers might ultimately want with my data, right? It's all about me, and it's either that I'm really interested in the technology. You know, I've heard there are two types of quantified selfers. Those that are there just because they like the technology and they like playing with devices and software and crunching data, and those that are trying to solve some like critical health issue, right? Having problems sleeping, they have, you know, problems with their stomach, all kinds of things, and they're trying to find a solution. So, you know, I'm trying to work at the intersection of bringing those sort of the values of those two communities together and design projects that both can sort of meet the interests and values of both sides, and it's very hard to do. And also just to say that this is just a tool, because this is actually probably a multidimensional space, and it's not like this clean XY axis, right? And so when you are designing a biomedical research study, it's not just the interest of the researcher and the participant. You often also have to take into consideration the interest of the institution who's sponsoring the research, and sort of the two parties who are trying to like come to some term of agreement about what the research is going to be about and who's responsible for what. There's also this axis of the institution, and sometimes that can play, that's sort of an invisible hand of research that can really play a strong role in the nature of research that gets designed. So I just wanted to, this is such a cliche, I hate to say it, but I think it's so true, and it's important also, I feel like, to sort of know where I'm coming from and the things that I think that are out there in the world that are very exciting. And so, you know, this quote, by the way, is just attributed to William Gibson. There, from what I learned, there wasn't any sort of written, he might have said it, but he didn't actually write it. I don't know if you guys know this quote, but so if you look at the cost of one human genome, you know, over the past 10 years, it's increasing at a rate faster than Moore's law. Most people who are outside of the biomedical sphere don't really have a lot of vision or a lot of insight into what's happening in the biomedical technology space. But there was a time that was not too long ago, this is the White Institute, where only the most elite institutions had the technical skill and the resources to do DNA sequencing, right? And so this was what the setup looked like to sequence the human genome. And there aren't a whole lot of, there are machines in there, but there's a whole lot of conveyor belts and people staffing benches. And increasingly, all of that's got collapsed down into desktop devices, you know, some of them coming with iPhone docks now. And starting to look towards starting to get a little bit more consumery, like mobile and disposable. So this is a mini ion. Right, so you drop your DNA sample right in there, and the data gets deposited right onto your computer. Right, so you can imagine, you know, your Roomba. You can imagine outfitting DNA sequencing devices on your air conditioning unit and on your Roomba, and start doing all kinds of environmental monitoring right there. That's not really that far away. And that these technologies are also getting out there in the wild as well. It's not just the quantified selfers who are putting on, you know, self-tracking devices and starting to learn about their own health. People are really adopting these technologies for their own pursuits. And so this is the 2013 UK Young Engineer of the World, Young Engineer of the Year, built a PCR machine in a sort of garage workshop and did some experiments on PCR. And just in Brooklyn, there's a new phenomenon called community labs, and this is GenSpace, where you can go roll up your sleeves. And it's sort of like a gym membership model and pay $100 a month or whatever the fee is and get access to biotechnologies. And so if you want to extract DNA, amplify it in a PCR machine, stick a jellyfish gene into E. coli, make it glow, and which is now on the AP biology curriculum, is that same experiment. So it's not that technologically savvy. Anybody can do it. And then in Boston, it's not just sort of device tracking and, you know, the bench work, but also the big data itself. So this is HackReduce in Boston, and it's a big data hackerspace. And so if you want to go get access to a high performance computer cluster and try your hand at Hadoop and take classes, like, those are now skills that are accessible to you. And so all I'm really wanting to impress upon you is that a lot of the skills that were once really solely the domain of experts in institutions are now out there for people to get involved with. And sometimes I'm inspired by a few stories of people who've been able to take all of these technologies and use them in ways that are incredibly inspiring. So this is Hugh Rehnhoff, and he has his daughter Bea, who had a syndrome that went to many, many doctors and was unable to get any answers that were satisfactory. And he happened to be trained by Victor McCusick, one of the leading human geneticists. Johns Hopkins wrote the Mendelian Inheritance of Man. So he's not exactly like a lay amateur, but this is the early fringe stage, something that these types of things might become more common. But, you know, he was unsatisfied with the answers that he was getting through clinical medicine and started his own research program to try to understand what was going on with his daughter. And actually just published a report after many years of this, including setting up a lab in his basement to make the whole process lower cost, to actually amplify the DNA and send it off to companies rather than paying companies like premiums to do some basic stuff that he already knew how to do. And just published on a candidate variant for his daughter's syndrome, and employed and recruited experts on his own to help this process. And then Sharon Terry, I don't know if anybody knows Sharon Terry, she now runs the Genetic Alliance, but she has published nearly 100 peer-reviewed articles, and she has no training as a formal scientist, but she has a training as a mom who was actually in the process of, in divinity school, getting a master's degree and had two kids with a very rare disease, and realized that there was nobody there to sort of service her needs, her family's needs. There was no diagnostic for this disease. There was no therapeutic. And so she started a biobank. She went around the world and collected all of the other families with this disease and brought them all together and said, we can do this ourselves. And they did. And they developed the very first diagnostic and owned the IP. And she's now gone on and set up something called the Genetic Alliance, which takes all those resources for what she did and makes it available to every other, you know, disease foundation that's being run from somebody's kitchen table. In some cases, much larger than that. And then, you know, Martine, you know, story, she recently had an FDA approval of a drug, and she was motivated. She was a successful entrepreneur, but she was motivated by her daughter who had a disease, and the only drug was this injectable drug that was very painful, and she was unsatisfied with that and went out and started a company in 1996 and got approval in like 2012, I think, or 13 by the FDA for a pill version of this drug. So, you know, these are three people who, against all odds, have taken the resources to really advance, you know, advance their own causes. And I think that these things are really... are fringe now, but are on, or what inspires me in my day to day to make those kinds of activities more mainstream. And I want to talk a little bit about another fringe activity that became mainstream just recently, and that's access to your own medical records. And sometimes it's really easy to lose sight of sort of history when you're in it every day. But going way back to 1978, there was this organization. Actually, my first real job was for a startup company in San Francisco. And the founder of that, the CEO of that, is an amazing woman who was the first executive director of the patient-centered medical library that was part of Plaintree, where they actually, rather than organizing medical information by what made sense to doctors, they organized it by what made sense to patients and had like patient-level information about diseases. Because at this time, before the internet, like the only information that you had about your own health and medical care was from your doctor, who it wouldn't be unsurprising if they lied to you because people were too delicate. You know, it was like cancer with a big C. There was a lot of stigma. There was a lot of, you know, I'll take care of you. You just take these pills. Or there was a lot of that going on. And so they started an effort to make patient-centered medicine a reality. And they set out this amazing mission statement that I just want to read. Through a set of experience-based and an evidence-based criteria, the program converts the aspirational aim of becoming more patient-centered into something that is defined, attainable, and measurable. And if you look at what the types of things that they were measuring hospitals on at the time in the 70s, they would do things like, did you hang the medical records on the inside of the patient examination room door or the outside, right? Was there, like, if I wanted to look at my medical records, are you going to make it easy for me or hard for me, right? And so fast forward to modern day, right? To just recently. And I want to point out there's this great FAQ that's on the New York Department of Health's website still. And I took a little quotation from it, right? January 17th, 2014, they sent out this friendly FAQ to all hospitals and people managing EHRs. And they said, we just want to remind you that laboratory tests cannot be reported directly to the patient except with the written consent of the physician or other authorized person, right? This is not equal access to your own medical records. This is an authorization model, right? Somebody else has to approve your interest in your medical records, right? So Plaintree, you know, 40 years ago would have given this an F, right? And this is sort of still happening. And the thing which is great, which is February 6th, 2014, they had to make an amendment to their FAQ. And it says, so February 6th, there was a federal rule, Ann Waldo's here. Actually, it's amazing that she's here. She's owed a lot of credit for actually getting this federal rule amended that gives patients federally protected rights to direct access to their lab test results, right? So February 10th, that New York Department of Health had to issue a new FAQ. And the question was, will the department follow the amended federal rule and allow patients direct access to their completed laboratory results? You know, yes. a big why, right? And so you can go look that up. And then, so they had to like send out a couple emails, oops, you know, disregard our threatening letter last month, and this is now, you know, it's threatening in the other way. Not only we said you can't do it, but now you must do it, you know. And so I just want to point out that in terms of, like, I'm just really shocked, honestly, that this is where we are, and that 40 years of advocacy, right, with work by a lot of patients and clinicians, sort of just recently has led to, you know, equal access to your medical records. And so I'd like to conclude with sort of one big idea for discussion, which is something that's really close to my heart, which is, you know, why shouldn't we make equal access to your research record also a federally protected right? And if we were to start the advocacy today on that, you know, if history is our guide, then we should expect to be successful, you know, 2015 or 2050-ish. And can we put together a five-year plan for making this happen? And so one of the research studies and one of the programs that I work on, this is a Robert Wood Johnson Foundation-funded effort and a Knight Foundation-funded effort, is really trying to help researchers and participants with this mode of equal access to research data. And I don't want to pretend that is like the solution to end all solutions, but I think it's very powerful. And that, you know, when people actually have access, if they want it, to the raw data, then there's a lot of downstream opportunities that are available now, where if you have access to your data, you can then donate it to other causes you care about. There can be a parallel track, right, to whatever the researcher wants to do and whoever the researcher wants to partner with, right? You can build a longitudinal integrated research profile that can be incredibly valuable, and that we can sort of, all of the investments that we make in characterizing people and trying to understand their biology and their health, that can get reutilized and reused over and over again by other researchers, rather than just building a bunch of unconnected silos that, you know, today we're going to look at this one gene and this one corner of their medical record, and over here we're going to look at these two things, but you know, those things are never the archipelago data silos, I've heard it called. And then as you get a longitudinal integrated research profile, right, there are like new questions that are possible. So the first, just to spend 1 second on this, so the first three partner studies for Open Humans involves genomic data, microbiome data, and viral data. And there are three studies, one research is at Harvard, one's at NYU, one's at UCSD, and they're looking at, they're doing their own separate analysis. And so now people who are signed up for all three of these have the ability to, you know, build a private integrated profile with all of those data, and they could choose to donate that data to a fourth researcher who might want to look at the relationship between something like, you know, what does the genetic background in my body say about the community of microbes that live in my nose? And does that community of microbes that live in my nose impact my susceptibility to the flu? You know, and the questions that you get, I get more sophisticated, you know, with this, and less expensive, right? So, and this goes back a little bit to, this requires innovation and governance. And when I set up the sort of design workflow and all the friction and the part of designing a research study, that equal access is really, really, I think, really needed for innovation, and we need more researchers to try this out. But it's really, really hard to do, and there are a lot of barriers that relate to governance and technology and policy. So I also want to talk just for 1 second about something else that really inspires me. Because in my view, there are sort of three phases to participant-centered research. And we are like right in the early part of it, where we're still trying, you know, the participant just sort of came on the scene recently as somebody that you should consider in how you practice your research study, right? And it's still really hard if you want to do that. The researchers often are lacking the tools, right? You want to have granular the ability to give people the ability to control their data sharing and say, you know, I want my data to be made available to this steward or to this individual, but this data and not that data, right? Things that are now increasingly common in consumer applications, that people are getting used to the idea that they have circles and groups and they can manage in some sense different types of communications with different types of people, and the same will be true about health data. But right now, the tools that are available for that are just really coming online, right? Apple's Research Kit, we have the Open Humans platform, we have Genetic Alliance's peer platform, Synapse by Sage BioNetworks, and a few small startups like ProofPilot. But just to get to the point where like we're still not even close to the point that's really exciting, right? Because even if you are innovating around governance and platforms, right now that is so much work and that's so expensive and that's so hard to do that there's not even really time to think about making the research study something that's really engaging, right? And so I feel like that's when health research, you know, participation in health research becomes something that's a fringe activity to something that's a normal activity. You got to have all these things working together. And right now, we're still in the early phases. But on the engagements, just a few things that really inspire me. So first of all, does anybody know what the most popular page in the history of the New York Times is, being in New York? Anybody want to throw a few guesses out there? The most popular page in the history of the New York Times website. Obama elected. Anybody have any? 9/11, good guesses. Well, it's the dialect map. And this is a learning of the New York Times that says, you know what? When we actually make our news personalized about the individual, where we can like feed them information, but the more we can make it interactive and put that information in a context of the person, the more engagement we get with our readers. And so how many people took the dialect map? Way more than people who participated in health research. And that's the point, right? And there's some other, like, I just want to point out a couple of things that you should definitely check out this afternoon that are really amazing. And I think they're kind of, you know, foreshadowing some of the things you might be able to see in health research. And this one is amazing. This is the 538 blog. And the article is called Science is Hard. And it's a really, really good read. But in the middle of it is this amazing interactive experience where they take a data set and they sort of explain how the scientific process works and how the p-value that you want, and you can take this data set and you can like change the terms and the parameters and try to get to a significant result, right? And you could imagine the opportunities in biomedical research for, you know, rather than the annual postcard to you, that if you're signed up for some effort that's trying to discover a sort of a new feature of human health, that you might be a lot more engaged if there is a much stronger sort of educational interactive component to all that data that's being generated. And sort of combining all of my worlds a little bit, you know, I love this story. I feel like there's also some amount of truth in this idea that if you add a little bit of DIY, that really can determine the difference between success and failure. And I don't know if this is really a true story, but I like it, about brownie mix. Has anybody heard the story about brownie mix? And yeah? No? Was it? That's right. So in the very first version of the brownie mix was a total failure. And so they went back to the lab and were trying to figure it out. And it was because it was just like brownie mix and water, right? Stick in the oven, brownies come out. I'm like, oh, I'm not cooking. So rather than desiccating the egg, they took the egg out. So you had to like crack an egg into the mix and then add the water and then put it in the oven. So people like felt like they were cooking. And that's like the end of the story, right? It was like a huge success. And there's also a sort of a parallel story with IKEA. That even though IKEA furniture is not the greatest. It serves a purpose. We've all owned IKEA furniture. I still own a lot of IKEA furniture. But the rate of return of like people returning the products to IKEA are really low. And like people theorize about all the different reasons why. And one of them is because like you actually like put sweat equity into it. You had to build this thing, right? And like you own it, it's yours in more ways than just like it's your property. Like you built it, right? You cracked an egg into it. And one of the things that really inspires me with biomedical research and thinking about the new roles that participants in research can make is like, what are all the different ways that we can have people actually crack an egg into the research, right? And own it and be engaged and make it less of a transactional experience. And, you know, what kind of benefits, you know, social benefits would we get? I think enormous social benefits from getting much higher rates of engagement in an equitable health research enterprise. So that's it. Thank you for having me. Questions?
Questions? Is that on?
Is
that you in the back? Is that you, Karen? No.
So there are two topics I'd like to try and get your thoughts on.
Yeah.
The first is I spent a lot of time in the medical de-identification realm.
Yep.
And there are parties that are pushing quite actively to try and remove rare diagnoses, procedures from medical data because supposed privacy threats, that somebody could know that you have this disease and then gain access to the remainder of your medical information. And I have concerns because these populations are very small. And also, in terms of driving orphan drug development, we need at least fewer than 200,000 individuals, but we need, if we routinely redact that out of medical information, then we're not able to make those measurements to push the orphan drug laws that make it economically feasible to provide these drugs for rare diseases forward. And I just wondered
before you ask the second question, let me jump on that. And
okay.
Because I absolutely think that there's sort of been so much effort put around thinking about data protection that there has been a failure to discuss the sort of social benefits that accrue from data sharing, right? And like really vital to human health and suffering, and that people are harmed by this data not being available. And there's a lot of stories related to this, you know. And I think of Heidi Rehm's hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, you know, where you find these really rare genetic variants that are related to sudden heart attacks that are totally preventable. And like being able to track down the people with these rare variants and to understand which ones are really fatal and aren't will undoubtedly save the lives of many other people having those variants. And when you hide, when you make it hard to get at those variants, you are unable to realize those other social benefits. And so I think it's an area where it's sort of competing values, and it's not necessarily a moral fact that that variant needs to be protected or a moral fact that it needs to be out there. But it is, you know, those values between social benefit and, you know, personal protection that are at odds there. And so I don't know what else I can say on that, but it's a really important question. And also, I mean, you also have to question to some extent. I mean, you're the de-identification expert in the room, but you also have to sort of question, you know, how robust de-identification technologies are. You know, that, you know, even with not rare things, but just combinations of common things, you know, it can be possible to re-identify people. So you know all this. It's great to meet you, actually, in person.
Nice to meet you as well. The other thing that I wanted to do is just connect the dots between two things that you had brought up. One was the idea of kind of a dynamic consent in which you could select who you wanted to know which things about you. And then the hacking the scientific study thing from New York Times, yep. where you could selectively delete certain studies. I just wondered if you had any thoughts about the issue of consent bias in allowing there to be that kind of granular dynamic consent in which people select which things they're going to report, and whether there's any benefit in saying, we recognize your need to remove your own information if you desire, but there's a certain amount of characteristics about you that you're not able to hide. You could hide your entire medical record, but you can't hide your race, your age, your gender, because we need those things to do adjustments to try and show what the impact of consent bias might be.
So actually, let him keep the microphone, because I have a feeling I'm about to ask him a follow-up question on this. One part is, I'm not sure that necessarily the consent form is the place to do all of this work, or that you like need to do all this work in the consent form. So if a person has access to their data and they are given tools to control that data, then those tools can be part of a terms of use and not a consent. I just want to throw that out there. One of the projects I'm working on has IRB components and platform components, and we very specifically designed it in a way where there can be parallel universes, where for a research study, you agree that if you want to sign up in the research study, you only sign up if you're willing to give us these four pieces of information, right? And otherwise, you're not qualified. Where then you can do that, where you can sort of say your criteria. But at the same time, that data is available to individual, where in some other context, they may have different feelings about, or a different point in their life. They may have different feelings about what data they want to share with a different set of people, right? Anyways, maybe we can talk more about that, because it sort of depends also if you're talking about sort of a healthcare experience, or if you're talking about a research study that people, you just make an eligibility requirement that you shouldn't sign up unless you're willing to share these certain pieces of information. And there's some interesting work also that the Regenstrief Institute did on allowing people. So there's good data out there about the choices that people will make about their privacy and preferences, which vary widely. When they're given tools to hide information on the medical record, the physicians in this case are always able to override, but it's not automatically visible to the physician. They have to take an extra step where you could say, you know what, my dermatologist, who's looking at a mole on my forehead doesn't need to know about my STD. So I'm going to put that behind this thing. And if the doctor really feels like they need to know that, then they can break the glass and get in there, right? So people are trying that model. But I don't know, maybe we can go more deep into your specific case that you're thinking about on approaches for that.
I'm glad to take it on afterwards.
Okay.
So I got a question for you. If I think about the brownies, one of the things about the brownies is that the potential for outcome is very yummy, right? It's immediately yummy. It's very tasty. One of the challenges that happens when we think about medical research is that you're actually holding in your head two abstracted potentials. The abstracted potential of harms in all sorts of things, from the level of potential, costs or consequences on privacy, costs or consequences on insurance, costs or consequences of knowing something that you can't actually do meaningful action upon, and it's actually really scary, like a psychological cost. And of course, the potential for doing awesome. And one of the things that is really clear from the stories that you've talked about is that when people have a very real sense of the potential for awesome, they're much more likely to engage. I know I can help my kid. I know that I can actually do something to find out something about me that can make a difference in my life. And all of a sudden, we have a different reason of potential. It's more the brownie situation. So one of the things that I struggle with in all of this is, how do you model out and make meaning of potential in a way that actually can be realized sustainably within the population? Because I think about this, for example, in my own participation in 23andMe, which is that the immediate potential was just like, you know, a half fictitious map of where my genes might come from, which was just like, ooh, it's just curiosity, and I'm in the bottom left corner. But the other thing about it is that I was one of the people who signed up with the imagination that I might be able to help somebody by contributing. And that's, of course, not exactly how we've seen it come out. And this is one of the things I think is a really weird, different version of risk in a lot of what you're asking for, because you want millions of people with the potential of finding the narrow folks who could really make a difference. How do you give people a sense so that they're not burnt out in that process?
Yeah, so I struggle with this question, because one of the things that, you know, I think of it as, I draw a parallel to donating to social causes that people care about, right? And like financial donations. Do most people donate to 25 different nonprofits every year? Or do they like take their giving, their charitable giving, and focus in on like one or two issues or charities that they really care about and chase those, right? And so it is an open question right now. That sort of, if we fast forward, if this future actually manifests, and like you could go to a website and there were like 100 amazing research opportunities that were engaging, that talked about issues that you care about, you know, or were just, you know, interesting in some way, like what is the common, you know, phenotype going to be for people? Are people going to want to, you know, are they going to be investing based on just, you know, taking their energy and saying, you know what, I really, you know, Alzheimer's runs my family. I only have 1% mind share to really and time to dedicate to this. And so I'm just going to focus on all of those causes that are related to that. And we're going to go from, you know, zero participation now, the average sort of number of studies people participate in is zero to one. But that might actually be like a huge success if it actually people go to one, because I don't think it's going to go to 25, but like, you know, maybe it will. Is that what you're asking? I'm not really sure. But like we don't have right now, like we don't really have. The other thing is you often when you have a big catalog of things, like types of music, right? Like you focus in on like the genres that you care about, right? And that you can sort of have a criteria that helps you filter and find the things that you think are valuable. And that the number of opportunities that are so thin right now that like for you to go find something, there are no criteria. Like you're lucky to find a research study that if your criteria is like, you know, equitable access to data, well, you know, you can count them on one hand and like there is a five. So you don't really have a lot of choice in terms of like finding things you care about. It's just sort of like these are the five that exist. Right? And like it would be a dream to live in a world where you could go out and like we had, just like we have categories of music, you could find like the indie, right? The techie, the disease focus, the human variation focus, the fun focus, the something focused on learning and biological literacy, you know? So it's kind of hard to really think too long and hard about how that's going to look and what it's going to be like and what are the tools, because it's so far away to me. It feels so far away. Yeah.
So just one. Oh, go ahead, Mark.
It sounds like you suggest that there's a possibility for a regulatory framework to sort of come in and potentially free up the data, make it more open, increase accessibility and engagement with you know, patients, subjects, and participants.
Yeah.
How do you see that happening? I mean, do you think it's sort of a IRB, which, well, I doubt it's going to come from IRB or university IRBs, but are you thinking that it's more of a federal type of mandate? And I'm thinking a little bit about, you know, the Obama administration 2013 talking about open sort of research and data coming from Office of Science Technology Policy and those types of mandates.
Yeah.
I think that had to do with sort of government-funded research coming from agencies making, which has more of something like $100 million in R&D or something like that.
Yeah.
Do you see that sort of becoming a mechanism, or what's your sort of vision for how that would change?
Absolutely. So I've been involved on the periphery with PMI, the Precision Medicine Initiative, and OSTP. And the OSTP folks, I can tell you that there are there is a sort of mob, a gang of people who really care about this issue of equitable research and access to data and people having the ability to have some amount of ownership in that process, right? That I think that ultimately it will require some kind of federal rule, you know? But Anne, I mean, this goes to you. Like, there are lots of approaches. It's definitely the approach that's not going to work is IRB by IRB. So it's like very idiosyncratic, right? The way that, you know, you could take the same protocol to 10 IRBs and get 10 very different types of feedback. This one doesn't like this. This one approves it right away. This one takes a year, asks for 15 different types of changes, totally different from the other set of changes, right? They're run by people, and they're interpreting information, and they have their own sort of limitations and constraints and pressures and things. And so, you know, sometimes all it requires is just asking. So I run this event called Get Labs, where we invite some of the most well-characterized people on Earth to attend. And until recently, people have whole genome sequences. And so until recently, people who, you know, these whole genome sequences might cost $10,000 a piece, right? And were very expensive. And researchers couldn't afford to go do whole genome sequencing. And so I met a researcher here based in New York City who is getting a second PhD. He's a total nerd, neuroscience and philosophy, because he's really interested in smell. And so that sort of both has like a physical manifest. You have like sensors in your nose and your tongue and stuff that sends triggers to your brain. It's also part of your brain. Your brain has to receive that signal. So it's like part neuroscience and part how the brain works, or, you know, it's part physical and part how the brain works. And so to sort of get at this problem, well, like nose smell research isn't exactly a well-funded area. There aren't a lot of like smelling diseases, right? So there's no NIH grants. So he would get grants here and there about from perfume companies and things, food companies. But he wanted to know the sort of genetic basis to smell variation. And so I said, hey, you can come to Get Labs, but I'm going to make you a deal. You, in order to get access to this group of people, and you can invite them to donate all of their data for free that was done in some other study, you have to practice equal access and give all the people assigned to your study their smell phenotype data, right? And so he went to his IRB based here in New York, which happens to be the oldest IRB in the United States, and he said, he made an amendment to his protocol, and he said, I want to give smell phenotype data back to my participants. And they said, that's interesting. Nobody's ever asked us to return research data to participants in the history of the institution as far as that person knew. And they said, so, I mean, just think about that for a second. In terms of like where we are in history, it's like the first patient going to the doctor and saying, hey, can I get access to my medical record? And they're like, well, I don't know. Maybe. Nobody's ever asked me that before, right? And so he did, and they said, well, you know, we don't want to make a determination on smell phenotype data. Like, we want to bring everybody together, talk about the issue of access to research data sort of generically and make a decision about that. Like, as a general rule, if you, on the next scientist comes and wants to do it, and they came back, yes. They deliberated for 3 months and came back, yes, and it was like just before the event, and he came and he brought his little bottles of chemicals and waved them under the noses of people, and he would say, what do you smell? How strong is it, right? So in the IRB version, like there's some version of equal access where you could set up a program and you just go to every, you like set up smell research at every university and submit an IRB and say, well, I want to give smell phenotype data back to the research participants. And you sort of establish precedent that access research data is something that you do, right? And you do that, you know, for all data types at all universities or all IRBs, or you work at a federal level and try to operate there. But it's not going to be easy. And I don't actually have, I'm in the process of talking to people who actually know how to do something like this. And Anne, I don't know if you have any ideas off the top, if you want to throw them out there, if what approaches are, but.
This isn't something I've spent a lot of time cogitating on, so yeah. You know, my gerbil wheels are turning fast right now. But it does strike me that to address this problem, you know, dramatically and quickly, as opposed to over an agonizing pace where everybody in this room is going to be very old by the time it happens, if then, would be to create some platforms and grow the demand on a really big scale,
yeah.
and then the public will demand it and the regulators will respond. So take, you know, social networking, which didn't exist how many, 12 years ago?
Yeah.
And you know, by having, you know, initially there were three or four platforms, Facebook obviously totally dominated and the others faded away, but it became too big to contain by regulators to a certain extent. And so while there has been a lot of hand-wringing about privacy, you know, Facebook, you know, marches on. And you know, and now we sort of see that with Uber. You know, lots of hand-wringing about Uber and laws and taxis and disruption and so on. But it got out there, and the people loved it so much that it marches on, and it tends to win these political and legal battles. I think a number of things. I don't think that the world and patients could tolerate having hundreds and hundreds of platforms. Like you were saying before, yeah. If I've got 1% of my mind share on Alzheimer's, that's a lot, given yeah. everything else going on in my life. So if there are thousands of places on the web where I could donate my data, you know, I'm out. But if you could establish 2, 3, 4, maybe not much more than that,
yeah.
where my data is accessible to me conveniently, easily, instantaneously, and then there's kind of a central brokerage house for transmitting it. So it could be a little bit like donating, except it's actually free. It doesn't take anything out of your checkbook. It just takes a little out of your time. And you say, you know, my data would be valuable for Alzheimer's, so bing, there it goes. And then you, maybe you get a, maybe this website brokers requests. You know, they can see your data on a de-identified basis. Researchers can see some stuff that says, that one looks interesting, and they could send you a request and say, we really think you look like you might have a marker to prevent HIV from blossoming into AIDS. Would you donate for that study? And you go, sure.
Yep.
But I don't think that we can afford to have more than, you know, a couple of platforms and brokers doing this. But I would just love to see it be built within existing law, pushing to the edges of existing law, and then change the laws further, because I think trying to get Washington to change it first is going to be super hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, something like that. Yeah, I think so. And actually, that could kind of work with the dynamic consent model. You know, I have some familiarity with what Genetic Alliance is doing there. And, you know, Facebook is a dynamic consent. You turn it on, you can turn it off. You can now have circles where you share certain things. But back to Dan's idea, I hadn't thought of that either, but maybe a condition of participation that would be reasonable would be to include certain basic demographic elements so that you do know my age and gender and, you know, you'd have to tell me what else is really critical to know. But that way, if I elect not to share my data, you know, someone like you, a statistician, can come behind and correct for the consent bias. Is that kind of what you were getting at before?
I am sadly attentive to the fact that we are out of time, but I am deeply grateful. Let's all give a round of applause to Jason for his great presentation.